So welcome to the third class in permutation and combination, where we will study a topic called partitioning. Let's give a couple of minutes more for everybody to join and then we'll start. Okay, I think everybody's here. Let's quickly go over the concepts that we've already done in PNC as a revision for partitioning. So here are the concepts we need to No. The first is the rule of AND. And the rule of AND says that if activity 1 can be done in m ways and activity 2 can be done in n ways, then the number of ways in which activity 1 and activity 2 can be done is basically m into n, right? So we've done this in one of the previous classes. The rule of OR says that again, if action 1, activity 1 can be done in m ways and activity 2 can be done in n ways, then activity 1 or activity 2 can be done in m plus n ways. Yes, excellent. Next was the basic number of ways in which to arrange R out of n items. And for arrangement, we talk about permutations. And we say that the number of ways in which this can be done is called NPR. And this is an expression whose value is equal to n factorial upon n minus R whole factorial. And the best way to remember NPR when you're calculating the value is that it is a product of the first R terms in the expansion of n factorial. Right? Okay. Now let's look at choosing R out of n items. Choosing means the order doesn't matter, only the final set of selected items matters. And we said that this is given by the expression NCR. The best way to think of NCR is NPR upon R factorial. So if you write down the expansion of NPR also, you get that NCR is n factorial upon R factorial n minus R whole factorial. And if you look at this expression, if I were to replace the value of R with n minus R, so if I asked you in how many ways can you select 2 out of 5 items, it's the same as saying in how many ways can I reject 3 out of 5 items. If I replace the value of R by n minus R, I get the same expression. So we say that NCR is also equal to NC n minus R. Yeah, and the last thing we need to remember is arrangements with repetitions, which says that if there are m objects of one type, there are n objects of another type, and there are p objects of yet another type, then there will be some double counting because of these items being identical. So the number of unique arrangements of all these objects, the total number of objects is m plus n plus p, so the number of unique arrangements is m plus n plus p whole factorial upon, and we divide with the factors that cause the repetition. So that's the formula for arrangements with repetitions. Right. So that's what we needed to revise. Now let's go to partitioning. What is partitioning? Partitioning asks the simple question, in how many ways can n items be divided into R areas? So here we'll say balls and boxes. In how many ways can n balls be divided into R boxes? Now, depending on whether the balls and boxes are distinguishable or indistinguishable, we also say distinct or indistinct, there can be four different cases. And here are those cases. They may both be indistinguishable, they may both be distinguishable, or any one of them may be distinguishable and the either indistinguishable. Some of the cases are trivial. What we'll focus on today is this case. And there's a whole field of PNC devoted to just this case. And that's what we'll focus on today. We've done the other ones in the classes prior. So we'll take with a concrete example. It says, five indistinct balls, three distinct boxes. In how many ways can we distribute the balls amongst the boxes? Here as well, there are certain cases to be made. We call this approach stars and bars, but I'll come to it in a second. Let's take the first case where we do not allow empty boxes. Okay? That means that each box should have at least one item inside. Now, those five indistinct balls, I'm going to represent with five indistinct stars. That's what they look like. Right? Now, instead of trying to put these in the boxes, let's take a slightly different arrangement. There were three boxes. Let me represent those three boxes like this. This isn't enough. I need to uniquely identify the boxes. So I'm saying these are boxes 1, 2, and 3 respectively. Now, may I remove this boundary wall from the box? So this boundary wall, let's get rid of it for a second. Okay. Also, let's get rid of this boundary wall. All three boxes are still uniquely identifiable. In fact, I don't even need the bases of these boxes. So I'm going to represent these boxes now with these two bars. And I'm going to say that all the area before the first bar can be thought of as box one. All the area beyond the second bar can be thought of as box 3, and the area between the two bars is box 2. We've slightly changed our way of thinking about this. Pay attention for a second. We've moved from 3 identifiable boxes, the distinct boxes. We have moved to 2 indistinct partitions. The order of the partitions doesn't matter. However, by placing the partitions, we can uniquely identify the boxes. So think of partitions, let's call them P for a second. Suppose I said this is one P and this is another. It doesn't matter in which order they come, but once they have been placed, then the area before the two P's, so this area is box 1, the area between them refers to box 2, and the area beyond the two P's refers to box 3. Any doubts with this? Okay, excellent. So what that means is, since we move from boxes to partitions, we then need to change our paradigm slightly. Now, instead of placing the stars in the boxes, we are going to place the partitions amongst the stars. But because it says empty boxes not allowed, let's ask ourselves this. Can a partition be placed here? That's right, Ankur. A partition cannot be placed there because that would imply that the first box becomes empty. So if there were a partition here, then this entire area would become empty. We're not allowing empty boxes. Okay. So in this case, box 1 would become empty. We're not allowing that. Similarly, can I say that a partition cannot be placed here? Because that would imply that box 3 is empty. Okay. Great. Tell me the case in which box 2 would become empty. When would box 2 become empty? Sure, but how would it look graphically? Where would my partitions be placed so that box 2, correct Muthu? Muthu Kumar is correct. If you place two partitions in any one gap, then the space between them, which was supposed to be box 2, would now be empty. So let's look at what cases we are not allowing. We cannot allow a box to be placed in the gap before the first star. We cannot allow a box, a partition to be placed in the gap after the last star, and we cannot allow two partitions to be placed together. Yeah. So what are the things that are allowed? If we had five stars, we have gaps between them. How many gaps do we have where we can place the bars? Correct, Vikram. So that means these four gaps are the places in which I can put the bars. I can't put them before or after or two of them consecutively. Also, can I say that in each gap, only one partition can be placed? We still allow a partition to be placed here. Yes? So we're saying there are, now consider this, there were five stars. As a result of that, we've got four gaps in which we can place the bars. So if there had been n balls or n stars, how many gaps would I get in which I can place the bars? Brilliant. We would have n minus 1 valid places in which to place the bars. Okay. I had three boxes, so I ended up with two partitions between them. If I have r boxes, how many partitions would I end up with? Correct, Mohan. We would end up with r minus 1 partitions. Now, let's look at one case which would be a valid placement. This is a valid arrangement in which box 1 has 1 star, box 2 has 2 stars, and box 3 has 3 stars. Okay. We said there are now n minus 1 gaps in which to place r minus 1 partitions. If I select a gap in which to place a partition, in how many ways can I place a partition there? Suppose I said that this is the gap in which I want to place a partition. Now, Mohan, let's not get ahead of ourselves. We'll come to that. Since exactly one bar can go in a gap, if I have chosen that gap, then there is only one way of placing a bar. Is that a fair statement? Okay. So we're following the rule of AND. Let's go back to the rule of AND. Activity 1, M ways. Activity 2, N ways. Activity 1 and activity 2, M into N. So what are my two actions that I'm doing here? The first action is selecting the gaps in which to place the bars. The second action is actually placing the bar. And we said that the number of ways in which you can... Yes, Uncle, you could use NPR. We are trying to simplify this, and we'll come to how we can use NPR in just a second. Okay? So we said our two actions are now selecting gaps and then placing bars in the gaps. So let's call them action 1 and action 2, and that AND gives us an INTO. But we said the number of ways in which we can place a partition in a gap is exactly 1. Is that okay? Okay. Then, can I just get rid of this entire expression? Because the INTO 1 is not going to change anything. So, all this comes down to is to say, in how many ways can I select r minus 1 gaps out of n minus 1 gaps? And in each of those gaps that I have selected, I will place one bar each. Right, here's what we've done. We said now it reduces to selecting r minus 1 gaps out of n minus 1 gaps in which to place the partitions. Then this is nothing but selecting r minus 1 objects out of n minus 1 objects. And our formula for combinations gives us that this is nothing but n minus 1 c r minus 1. We have selected r minus 1 gaps out of n minus 1 gaps. Any doubts here? Okay. Great. Let's take the case. I'm just going to skip this example. I'll come back to this. Okay. Let's take the case where empty boxes are allowed. Okay? So, you'll excuse that. Let's talk about it as empty boxes now allowed. Now, what has changed? If you look at your stars, I can now put a bar here. I can now put a bar here and I can put bars together. So the question is there any restriction on a linear arrangement of stars and bars? Right, for those who weren't clear on the question, basically asked, is there any linear arrangement which is now not allowed? Any linear arrangement of bars and stars which is not allowed? Let's take our extreme cases. If I put all the bars together, suppose I put all the bars here, then that would tell me that all my boxes are empty except the last one. All the stars are now in the last box. Any other should be valid anyway. So now can I say that all linear arrangements of stars and bars are valid? Okay, so let's figure out what the number of those arrangements is. Let's go back to what we said about arrangements with repetition. Here we have n stars, and if we had r boxes, we would end up with r minus 1 partitions. So we have n objects of one type and we have r minus 1 objects of another type. Our formula for repeated arrangements tells us that the total number of unique arrangements should be the sum of these whole factorial in the numerator upon the factorial of each of these terms separately in the denominator to adjust for the double counting. Is this valid? Okay, but this is a cumbersome enough formula in itself. The thing to note here is that the two terms in the bottom sum up to the terms in the numerator. Can I then say that this is nothing but the number of ways of selecting r minus 1 out of n plus r minus 1. Mathematically, they're equal. And that's the way to remember this formula. Okay, but we're not yet done. We want to show the relationship between this case where empty boxes were allowed to when the empty boxes were not allowed. And let's take an example for that. So, consider this question. X plus Y plus Z is equal to 13 is our equation, and we are asked how many positive integral solutions to this equation. So first question, what is positive integral? Where do positive integrals start? Correct. Yes, in the many natural numbers. So they start at 1 and they go on to infinity with a gap of 1. That's important to remember, right? So consecutive numbers starting at 1 are all positive integrals. So basically this question is asking how many solutions in which x, y and z have positive integral values. So the way I like to think of this question is instead of, because on the face of it doesn't look like a PNC question, right? But look at it this way. I've got three boxes and they are identifiable because they are x, y and z. And right now, they have nothing in them. So their values are 0, 0 and 0 respectively. Yeah. And instead of this 13, I'm going to say that we have 13 ones. Why 13 ones? Because those 13 ones, when I distribute them across these three boxes, I will end up with different solutions. Different distributions will give me different solutions. Yeah. But our case says that we will not allow, we want only positive integrals, so we will not allow empty boxes. Yeah, we can do this two ways. The first is we can directly use our formula. Our formula for when there were n objects and r boxes and empty were not allowed. So the way I write it is empty and cross, empty not allowed, was n minus 1 cr minus 1. Yeah, which in our case would give us 13 minus 1 c3 minus 1, and that would give us 12 c2. Any doubts? That's the direct formula, right? But now let's try and establish a connection between when empty are allowed and empty are not allowed. The other way to look at it is if empty boxes are not allowed, so first let's get rid of that criterion. Let's put each one of those, let's take this one, the one that's just disappeared from our screens, and put them here in this box. So this box is no longer a value of 0, this box has a value of 1. Similarly, let's take another one from here, it doesn't matter which one, and put it in Y. And let's take another one and put it in Z. So what we've done is, we've at least taken care of that requirement that they should not be empty. Now, can I say that any distribution of these 10 that are left, not 13 anymore, 10 that are left in these three boxes, even if I don't put anything in any one box, that means I have now reduced it to a case where I have to distribute 10 identical items into three distinct boxes where empty boxes are allowed. Yeah. So now this case has become one of x plus y plus z is equal to 10, where empty boxes are allowed, and that we would have said instead of positive, we would have called it non-negative integral solutions. And what was our formula for that? Our formula for that was n plus r minus 1 cr minus 1. Our n is 10, r is 3. Do you see that we've ended up with exactly the same answer? But this time, we've tried to show that one case can be reduced to the other. And that's all there is in partitioning. Any questions? Brilliant. Thank you for attending. That's the end of the class. Take care.